Welcome back! My name is ballerscuba. This is Video Games Over Time. We are still in 1982. And today, we're going to talk about the ColecoVision. The story of the ColecoVision takes us back to Coleco. We have talked about Coleco in the past. Coleco released the Coleco Telstar, a first-generation home console, in 1976. They would continue to release first-generation consoles through 1977, then pulled out of the home console market in 1978. That was the last time we talked about them. In 1978, Coleco turned to handheld electronics, a market dominated at the time by Mattel. Coleco found success in electronic quarterback, as well as their head-to-head series of two-player sports games. Coleco also released educational handhelds in products like the Electronic Learning Machine and the Quiz Whiz. With that success, Coleco started to turn back to video games. Coleco released mini arcades, small electronic games inspired by arcade games. Coleco would find success in releasing mini arcade versions of Donkey Kong, Ms. Pac-Man, and tabletop mini arcade versions of Pac-Man, Donkey Kong, Galaxian, and Frogger. Those tabletop mini arcades would sell 3 million units within a year, with Pac-Man itself selling 1.5 million units. Despite this success, Coleco president Arnold Greenberg saw handheld electronics sales declining and wanted to return to the home console market. Work on a new console had begun behind the scenes years earlier. Engineer Eric Bromley claims that as early as 1979, he was working on a console that could replicate the power of the arcade cabinets. However, the cost of the components prevented further development. In 1981, the Wall Street Journal published an article stating that the price of RAM was dropping, and work continued on the console, now named the ColecoVision. Coleco saw the success of Atari's ports to their home console in the Atari 2600, so Coleco wanted to have home ports of arcade games be a main feature of the upcoming ColecoVision. Eric Bromley went to Japan to meet with Nintendo's president, Hiroshi Yamauchi. Yamauchi initially only offered obscure titles, but Bromley saw a Donkey Kong cabinet. Donkey Kong at this time had not been released in the United States, but Bromley saw that it would be a hit. Bromley then asked for a license for Donkey Kong directly. Yamauchi agreed, only under the condition that Coleco provide $200,000 by the end of the day, over $600,000 in 2021, and that Coleco would give Nintendo $2 for each unit sold, over $6 in 2021. Coleco agreed to these terms and returned home, although they did not have a formal contract. Coleco would later find out, at that year's Consumer Electronics Show, that Yamauchi had also given the rights to Donkey Kong to Atari. Coleco was able to get Yamauchi to sign a formal contract at this point, affirming that Coleco had the rights to Donkey Kong. The ColecoVision features a Zilog Z80 microchip, as well as a variant of the Texas Instruments TMS-9918 video chip. We have talked about the Zilog Z80 several times before. It was originally released in 1976 and has been ubiquitous in the video game industry since. The Texas Instruments TMS-9918 video chip was initially released in 1979. Despite the age of these chips, the combination of these two microchips would make the ColecoVision a powerful console for the time. Coleco released the ColecoVision in August 1982. Packed in with the console was Donkey Kong. This was a surprise to critics, as Donkey Kong was seen as the main reason to purchase a ColecoVision, so it was seen as giving away a bestseller for free. The ColecoVision's controllers featured a joystick and a numeric keypad. The idea would be that the keypad would have overlays placed on top to explain how specific games could be played using the numeric keys. The ColecoVision was also advertised as a system that could be expanded. At the time of its release, the ColecoVision also sold expansion module number 1 separately. Expansion module number 1, also known as the Atari 2600 expansion, allows the ColecoVision to play any Atari 2600 cartridge. This expansion was essentially a clone of the entire 2600 all by itself, with the ColecoVision console only providing power, clock input, and audio and video output from the expansion. With this expansion, the ColecoVision, on its release, had the largest library of video games of any home console on the market. On top of the Atari 2600's library, there were 9 games available to the ColecoVision by the end of 1982. Most would be ports of existing arcade games, many of which we will talk about in our honorable mentions video of 1982. To play the port of Turbo, Sega's 1981 racing arcade game, Coleco introduced expansion module number 2, also known as the driving controller. The driving controller featured a steering wheel and a gas pedal, which would plug into the controller port of the console. By the end of 1982, the ColecoVision proved to be successful. It sold over 500,000 units by Christmas of 1982, surpassing the sales of its competitor, the Atari 5200. It would take some time to see an international release of the system. CBS Electronics would release the system, renamed the CBS ColecoVision, in Europe in 1983, almost a full year after the original release. With the release of the ColecoVision, Atari saw another competitor on the home console market, and this one was proving to be more successful than what Atari was able to produce. We will continue to keep an eye on the games and hardware of the ColecoVision as we continue. We will also hear from Coleco and its president, Andrew Greenberg, again in the future. That will do it for the story of the ColecoVision for now. My name is Baller Scuba. This has been Video Games Over Time. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in our next video when we take a look at the next generation.